Hey everyone, welcome to Simulink for Chemies. Today we're going to model the real-world behavior of a system using Simulink. In the last screencast, we created a Simulink model to describe the behavior of a series of pressurized tanks. Here we're going to follow the same strategy, but for a system that's a little bit more complicated. In the picture, we have a reactor with a recycle stream. The stream going into the reactor has an inlet concentration of some species A, CAN, a flow rate Q, and a temperature T in. It comes out of the reactor with a different concentration of A, CA out, and a different temperature. Some of the outlet stream is recycled back through a heat exchanger, which is the circle with a zigzag inside, which cools it back down to the inlet temperature. The outlet flow rate is the same as the inlet. We have the transfer functions describing the system in the Laplace domain. These came from material and energy balances done on the reactor. The outlet temperature is shown to be a function of the inlet temperature, the flow rate, and the outlet concentration. The outlet concentration, in turn, can be expressed as a function of the inlet concentration and the outlet temperature. We also have a plot of the deviations to the input variables. There's a step change in the flow rate Q and two step changes in the inlet temperature. The concentration experiences a ramp increase and then just stays at its new steady state value after 4 minutes. So our objective is to determine how these changes in TN, Q, and CAN affect the outlet concentration and outlet temperature. And all deviation variables will be plotted for 20 minutes. We'll make sure to label the arrows as we go along, so that way we can keep our units straight. First, we'll make a diagram for the mass balance. This equation says that the outlet concentration is equal to one term minus another term. Therefore, we should put a subtraction block on the screen. The output to this subtraction block will be CA out. When diagramming the first term, we need to think CA in is multiplied by this transfer function to make the first term. So the CA in arrow goes to the transfer function and is then sent to the subtract block. In the same way, T out goes through its own transfer function before going to the subtract block. Now that we've made a diagram for the mass balance, we'll make a separate diagram for the energy balance. How do we form T out from all of the signals and transfer functions that we have? We're going to need to add and subtract some terms. Now, instead of going into the library browser to get another subtract block, we can just click on this one, Control C to copy, Control V to paste, and then if we double click on it, we can change the ports from plus minus to plus plus minus. Because our energy balance has three terms, we need to make sure that all three of those terms are being sent to the block. There we go. Now the first term in the energy balance times this transfer function plus Q prime times this transfer function minus CA out times this other transfer function. And this all forms T out. So now that we have a mass balance and an energy balance, how do the mass and the energy balances relate to one another? Some of our labels match in the mass and the energy balances. So we can connect those. T out is the output of the energy balance, but it's also one of the inputs for the mass balance. So we can delete this arrow and connect this one here. In the same way, CA out is an output here and an input here, so we can connect these together. Now let's connect all of our deviation variables to the mux and scope. So we have T in, T out, CA in, CA out, and Q. Now that we've drawn out how all of our variables are related to one another, we're ready to add the sources based on our input graph. Let's tackle the easiest one first. The flow rate, Q prime, has a step increase of 5. So we'll connect the Q prime arrow to a step change of 5. Go in here, go into sources. It's at a step time of 0, and it goes from an initial value of 0 to a final value of 5. For the inlet temperature, it increases by 3 at time equals 3, and then decreases by 2 at time equals 7. So there are two steps in the graph, which means that you need two steps and an add block to create the signal on the Simulink diagram. So we can copy this. We can double click on this and change it to two plus signs. Now for the first step, it occurs at a step time of 3. And it goes from an initial value of 0 to a final value of 3. The second step occurs at a step time of 7 and goes from an initial value of 0 to a final value of negative 2. Because once a step occurs, the step stays in effect. So in order to make it go higher or lower, you have to add another step to it at a later time. The inlet concentration is sort of a strange one. It starts out with a ramp source, but then it stays stagnant. So how do we model this given the blocks that we have? We'll start with the ramp input. We can go and put a ramp down. It needs to have a slope of 2 over 4 or 1/2 and occur at a start time of 0 with an initial output of 0. Now, at time equals 4 minutes, this ramp stops ramping. It becomes a flat line. So how do we model this? If we add another ramp with a slope of negative 1/2 at time equals 4 minutes, the increasing of the first ramp and the decreasing of the second ramp will cancel each other out, and the graph will flatline. So we'll add another ramp, make the slope negative 0.5, and give it a start time of 4, and keep the initial output at 0. We'll also, because we're adding the signals together, we'll need an add block from over here. All right, now all of our signals are complete. They all have a source and they all go to the same sink. So we'll save, set the timer to 20 minutes, run the simulation. So the first things we should look at when we're assessing this graph are the deviations in our input variables. Do they match the behavior on the graph that we were given? Well, it looks like they do. When we auto-scaled, we lost the ability to see the step change in flow rate, which goes from 0 to 5. So it's this line and then this line over here. And that's constantly in effect. There's a step change increase in 3 and then a decrease to 1. And then here we have our ramp and then the stagnation right there. Well, now we know all the changes to our input variables, but we still don't know the red and the magenta graphs. Let's see if we can figure out which one is which based on their behavior, which one is outlet concentration and which one is outlet temperature. So the magenta one is reacting at the same time as the step change in inlet temperature. So there's a curve, and then there's the step change in yellow, and then there's a different curve, and then there's another step change and a different curve. So because this one is so dependent on the inlet temperature, we can look back at our equations and see that outlet temperature is dependent on inlet temperature, but outlet concentration is not in the same direct way. We can see that the magenta is the outlet temperature, and therefore the red is the change in outlet concentration. Well, there you go. If you want to learn more about using Simulink to solve process control problems, check out our playlist on the Lafayette CHBE YouTube channel.